my history, there were three global coral bleaching events. One in 1997, second in 2005, third in 2016, and Great Barrier Reef bleached again this year. Now, I want to ask a simple question. Are we still human when the Great Barrier Reef is not there, knowing that we created its destruction? So, for climate change, people say, okay, we need to do adaptation because we can't stop it, right? The picture you see on this on the side is the sea walls that the Netherlands have put up. London has a flood barrier which can handle tides from a storm surge up to, I believe, 20 feet. How is India going to adapt? How is Sri Lanka going to adapt? We don't have adaptation options. The people who will suffer from climate change is disproportionately people in the south, people who are poor, people who are vulnerable, people in countries like yours and mine. The other picture is a picture of a study that WWF made about adaptation options for sea turtles. Now, I still haven't found a sea turtle who actually managed to read this book, because adaptation is always human-centric. I'm a Buddhist. Our philosophy is that loving kindness to all species in the planet, not just humans. But I want to say something, because in the Paris Agreement, the most remarkable plan for impact reduction, climate change mitigation, did not come from Europe, did not come from America, it actually came from India. For me, as a climate change and clean energy activist, one of the heroes of our time is Piyush Goyal, the energy minister for India, because he made solar energy affordable, workable, not only for India, but for the whole planet. So the solutions for the kind of environmental challenges we are having isn't really in the West, it's here. We will survive this if people like us make the transformation. And sometimes this is the piece that's missing, because we always wait for the solution to come from somewhere else. We are here because we make the world's best apparel. That's who we are. But what's the point of having the best sportswear if you can't breathe? This is Greenpeace slogan, campaign. Frank knows this quite well. But I want to make a correction. It's not only the global fashion brands. It's also the global fashion manufacturers. This is what this industry is doing. This is an actual picture. This river wasn't supposed to be red. This is in China. This is what we are doing in this industry. And this is why we are here, to talk about a different way. But also, fashion industry tends to be always labeled, especially in manufacturing, about the worst of our work. Okay, we are always labeled by, oh, you are dumping dye into the river, or you have factories that collapse. But this industry is also a very, very hotbed of innovation. And this is a factory that Nes built a few years ago. Sorry, 9 years ago. And this started the green building revolution, and in some ways at the forefront of how environmental sustainability came as a key issue for global fashion industry. So our company, Emmaus, our board gave us a challenge, right? And they said, okay, what is our long shot or moonshot towards environmental sustainability? We had three ideas here: reduce our negative impact, create positive impact, and imagine, right? Our board said, if you are going to bring us a proposal, when you present the proposal, we should be laughing at you. Otherwise, don't win the proposal. Because the kind of sustainability challenges that we spoke about can only be solved by action that is dramatic, that everybody in the board should start laughing at you when you say it. If they are not laughing, you are not doing enough. So here are some of the aspirational targets that we have for ourselves. Can we run our company in 100% renewable energy by 2025? While reducing our energy intensity by 50%. Can it be done? I think so. Can we run our operations with a 75% intensity reduction of water? We have mills, we have wet processing, and the answer is actually yes. And this is not zero liquid discharge, which is a great innovation in India that you export. So you should be really proud of it. But there are ways, because apparel industry, the way we make our products, still is like the internal combustion engine. It's outdated, it needs to innovate, it needs to move forward. We have 80,000 associates all over the world. Can we make impact to their own lives towards sustainability so that they live sustainable lives, so that the sustainability movement moves forward? Because if we can help them lead their lives sustainably, we make a much bigger impact than we can do as a company. And this is one of the most ambitious targets. For every square foot of land that we occupy, can we restore and reforest 100 square feet in a 10-year time? Okay. For a maize, that's over 30,000 acres of land. Why? Because this is what is needed to be done. So here's my call to action. We have historically, as an industry, I mean, there are exceptional companies always, have waited until the brands that we work with tell us, this is what you need to do, this is what you should be doing for sustainability. And that's fundamentally wrong. The reason is this. People who are likely going to be affected the most from climate change is not the people, the consumers, who's going to buy your clothes. They are not the ones who are going to get affected. It's people who work for our companies, who make their clothes, their families, their communities, their children, are the most vulnerable. As apparel manufacturers, we have to own the global sustainability agenda. It cannot be owned by global brands. It has to be owned by us. We need to know what needs to be done. We need to take initiative, and we need to ourselves set ambitious targets, because it's our countries, it's our people, and it's our planet. Second, we need to collaborate. This is not a manufacturer issue. This is not a brand issue. This is an industry issue, and it's a global issue. It's our issue. We need to work together, not at cross purposes, not at duplicating the work, not at doing stupid things that doesn't drive impact. Because that's what this industry is doing as sustainability. That's what we do as compliance. That's what we do as chemical management. It simply is not enough. And the third thing is that what we do has to create impact. Okay? It's not filling papers. It's not showing forms to customers. It is creating actual impact. It's reducing our negative impact. It's creating positive impact. And there's a fantastic tool called Higindex. Just one thing about this tool, because most of the tools that I've seen as a manufacturer that came from the brands always was focused on, have you done this? Have you done that? Have you done that? The other thing. It's all about compliance. This tool is not about compliance. It's about impact reduction. It's about creating positive impact. So first time, it's a tool that is really looking at sustainability as what it is and setting a platform for us to create change. Now, I gave you a lot of horror stories. The thing that I need to tell you is that nothing we do is likely going to save the Arctic or the polar bears. Nothing we do from this point of time is going to save any of the coral reefs. Because ice actually has much larger inertia, So the melting trend that we have set is going to go for 200 to 300 years before it can be reversed, right? But one thing that collects us as humanity is actually that we have hope and ingenuity. So there's always a lot of things to do, we have capacity to do, and here's the invitation for all of us. Join SSE, do your own sustainability strategies, and drive impact. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Vidhura. Hello, everyone. I'm Betsy Blaisdell. I'm Vice President for the Hague Index at the Sustainable Apparel Coalition. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce our next panel, which is going to take this amazing context that Vidhura has set about why personally and professionally we really need to take this as a call to action to find a new direction in our companies to pursue a sustainable direction. I'm going to bring up some manufacturers to the stage who are going to talk to you a little bit more about how they've internalized this message in their own companies and how they're setting a new example for us all to move towards a more sustainable direction. Panelists, please come on. Great. Vidhura needs no introduction. So I'm going to have my two other panelists go ahead and start. Maybe Ed Laura, if you could introduce yourself.
Good morning, everybody. So I'm Anne-Laure de Marcy. I work for TAF Apparel. We are cut and sew manufacturers. We have 10 manufacturing in Southeast Asia. We sew one in Ethiopia. So I'm the senior manager for the Anonzo Topics in my company.
Hi, good morning everyone. Myself is Naresh Jain. I'm Chief Sustainability Officer for Aditya Birla Fashion Retail. Aditya Birla Fashion Retail is part of Aditya Birla Group, which is one of the leading companies in India. Apparel and brand business, which I represent, we have that brand. Virtually, Vansen, Alessori, Italian, Tibetan, Pantaloon, and we are one of the leading retailers in India. We have our own manufacturing as well as supply chain based in India.
Great, thank you all for joining. So, today we're going to be spending a lot of time talking about how do we move towards a more sustainable future and our toolkit as manufacturers for moving in that direction. After this panel, we're going to be spending a lot of time talking about the Hague Index as one tool. Vidhura just gave a great introduction to that. And I guess my first question for each of you is, how were you introduced to the Hague Index and why do you use it? Maybe Dr. Tammy Oster.
We started the Hague Index. We are part of that SSE. And in 2012, when SSE was formed, we were the only member of it. First pilot for Hague Index, when it was started in 2013, we started that pilot and we then taken that index into our brand, manufacturing and then supply chain. So we were doing that pilot with SSE and we found that Hague Index is one of the good tools which is harmonized across all that value chain. Before Hague Index, we were finding that so many tools and so many methodologies